Good afternoon. Welcome to this class on wildlife habitat evaluation and management. I'm going to talk something very important in the sense that it will really show the use of remote sensing and GIS technology in wildlife habitat evaluation, which helps ultimately in better management or scientific management of a protected area, wildlife sanctuary, national park, or tiger reserve, or conservation reserve, all categories. Only because technology gives factual analysis of the land use, land cover, and many other habitat factors, which otherwise is difficult without the technology. So I'm going to talk not on lands, as you see on in slide one, but surely it indicates that I'm going to cover some wild animals and how the habitat should be, or rather can be evaluated using GIS, remote sensing, and models, modeling, etc. So this one simply shows you as to how many protected areas in the country are there. National parks are about 108. Sanctuaries are more than 560. Total area under protected areas is about 16 million hectares, which is about around 4 point some percent. Maybe if you include the proposed sanctuary, it will be around 5% of the geographical area of the country. Tiger reserves have swelled to about 28. These tiger reserves also include sanctuaries and national parks and reserve forests are notified forest areas. So also the biosphere reserve, which is a large unit, and 18 of them are there, and several are under proposal stage. Conservation reserves were created about a decade back, and we have around 15 of them, maybe those under proposal. Are many more, and very soon we will have a new list which shows that protected areas by and large of all categories are increasing, with the hope that we should be able to conserve wildlife, which also includes plants and animals, to the level we would like to, and minimizing the disturbance otherwise happening in the protected areas everywhere in the country, not only in India but also abroad. And because as human population swells with period of time, with the passage of time, it has ultimately some pressure over forest. And if forests are under pressure, then surely wildlife, both plants and animals, are also under pressure. Their number, their frequency, their density, and their abundance is going to decrease than what we saw in our childhood. And this is a continuous degradation process of natural ecosystem, thereby affecting the ecosystem services and the aesthetic beauty of the systems for which they are famous for ecotourism or otherwise tourism, and also source of a lot of variety of plants and animals who are used for medicine, etc. So we need to conserve nature. We need to conserve not only protected areas but also other areas, so that we are able to use the resources sustainably and also leave something for the future generation. Otherwise future generations are going not to have any good idea about their ancestors. They say these fellows had no brains, they consumed everything, left nothing for us. Either they left everything polluted, degraded, or they have simply left nothing. This is the concept, and all technologies available in hand should be used to see that how we can use them for nature conservation, protected area conservation, planning, management, including forest planning, forest management, and forest monitoring. Next slide will show you as to what is the state of the locations of these existing and proposed protected areas in country. As you see the dots, each one indicates either a sanctuary, national park, a tiger reserve, or a conservation reserve. Our country is perhaps the only country in the world wherein protected area network is very well established. I used this word about 5 years back fairly well, but now you can say very well, because many of those proposed ones, nearly half of them have been legalized, regularized, and this network is very good. And we are the only country perhaps with the largest number of protected areas anywhere in the world. So we have that title, but then having title is not enough. Should be serious, use all resources at hand, including RSGIS and models, to see that how best we can manage our wildlife resources. as good as possible. And we have this onus on us because we are not the only and the last generation to consume whatever we see around it, but also we have a duty, a responsibility to consume less, recycle, consume as much as possible, because future generations too will depend upon same resource in times to come. Now, this shows the problems of protected air. We have many of them. You might be knowing when India became free, we had only one national park called Halley's National Park. Today it is called as Corbett National Park. And after 1947 till date, we have hundreds of them, and the number has increased like anything. This number has increased at a time when people were already there. There were railway lines created, lines drawn by British. There were already, you know, drainage systems modulated by the, you know, checks and dams and, you know, goons and other drainage made by irrigation people. There were already roads made by PWD. There were already human settlements made by humans themselves, and which increased in size and also increased in size and number of the people that lived in these settlements, or cities. And therefore, when these hundreds of protected areas were declared, there were already enough number of people all around, and they were drawing their resources from forest, whether it is protected area or not, because earlier it was not, now created. So there is a whole lot of conflict between forest department and local people all around in the country. Local people are least struggling with sustainable forest management, are leaving resource also for future generations. They have an attitude like a business person, how much I can draw and how much profit I can make, or can I extract something more than what I do for my household. And all kinds of people which are not local also want to include into forest, for either, you know, hunting an animal which has got market value, or a plant product which also has got commercial value. And maybe everybody is not doing this, but then overall attitude of the humans is that of a consumer, and he wants to consume everything that he can use. Unless protected, I think we are going to lose this invaluable resource which is around us in terms of biodiversity, in terms of wildlife, in terms of, you know, I mean, the, you know, undisturbed, serene, beautiful nature. But humans cannot survive without being part of the nature, and this coexistence is possible only when we are considerate and we think seriously of conserving nature and avoid things like which are harmful to the ecosystems in surroundings. Our fungi is that used to the extent which is bare minimum, I mean, derived minimum. Don't get into commercial activities as far as possible. Don't degrade the resource. Could be water, you can pollute. Indians are known to pollute more water than actually any other country is doing. And we use less and pollute more, kind of, so we try to spoil the resource value or our resource consumption. And we are least conscious about environmental, either let it be sanitation, environmental conservation. You know, planting tree is a slogan which is there from the last 50-60 years, but that is, by planting tree you cannot create an ecosystem which is a self-perpetuating entity and which is inhabited by humans, by all kinds of other organisms, including wildlife. So when these protected areas were created, there were already people and all infrastructure they wanted, either by, you know, any mechanism, political, social, economical, and then in the proximity were the wild animals and the domestic animals, and sometimes there's a whole lot of conflict between domestic animal and the wild animals. So you said we had problems with respect to this. Lack of sufficient fodder in some protected areas, there is serious, you know, lack of the sufficiency in terms of fodder and prey. For example, if you go to Gir Sanctuary and National Park, you find that water is available hardly for 3-4 months, and for the remaining part they get water supply, something like a water supply in any town or any city, and you feel miserable because day and night these water tanks are crisscrossing the whole sanctuary and National Park, and you get a feel as an unoriented person, whether you have come to a wild reserve or you have come to an area where water supply is very regular. Lack of sufficient drinking water, yes, this I have already said. Fraudulent prey could also be a problem, because when population density of animals, wild animals as well as sometimes in the periphery domestic animals increases, then the fodder becomes a scarce commodity, and similarly for carnivorous animals, prey becomes a scarce commodity. Many of these prey, they are hunted for their meat, and many tigers and leopards, and they are hunted for their skin, for their flesh, and for their nails, etc., etc. So foresters, I talk to foresters, they report that 60-70% time they are doing policing in forest area just to keep the resource intact or as it is, and only 30% or so time they are able to spend for the forest management, forest plantations, forest conservation or any other research and management activity. In cattle grazing, trampling and poor regeneration, that is another problem. India is known to be the biggest producer of milk, but if you ban all animals that graze in forest, this output of the milk will go down to 50%, and this big country will never stand in front of other countries which are big milk producers, but they surely don't graze their animals in the forest areas. When cattle go to the forest, their hoofs actually trample the soil and damage the seedlings and saplings in the forest and make the soil unfit for forest regeneration. Extraction of firewood, timber, fodder, non-timber forest product is another activity which is either legal or illegal. Allow people to get into forest, they will not see whether it is day or night, they are always ready, because it benefits them. Even if their needs are met from forest, they will extract extra so that they are able to sell. Smuggling out of forest of valuable non-timber forest product, even timber, is a big problem. How to check it? High density of wild animals in some protected area, again a big problem. For example, Chilla Sanctuary in Rajaji National Park has got about more than 250 elephants, and total area of sanctuary is 258 kilometers. Now, this kind of population density is not expected to be viable over long run, because there is a whole lot of competition among elephants and other high density animals. I'm sorry, I said 250 elephants. It is more than 100 elephants, and 258 square kilometer is the size of sanctuary. Even this is insufficient grossly for this elephant population, and therefore the fights and the kills and competition for survival among elephant is really very high. Proximity from settlements, roads and railway line, etc. is there, because by the time these protected areas were declared by an act of parliament or an act of state assembly, parliament act is even formalized when you create a national sanctuary is by the law, the act in the state assembly. Of course, proximity from settlement is a big problem, because access, if settlement is nearby and people have access to forest, they will start drying whatever they think. And most of them think, unfortunately, that it is their right to draw as much as they can. Fine, perhaps concept-wise not bad, but then if everybody thinks, then one day forest will be worth. And it's not that people who are surrounding the forest, they only draw. It's also people who are away from forest, they also depend on forest in terms of timber, in terms of medicinal plants, factories, they might be located quite far in Chennai or anywhere in Kolkata from Dehradun, let's say. But then they also depend on the medicinal plant and many other types of plants and animal products for making medicine for some other purposes and so on. Then after natural calamities, sometimes floods and fire will devastate a large chunks of forest. Fire naturally burns all small seedlings and even to high degree in saplings. Although trees in India are spared because the canopy is too high And trunk has that lot of water, so it will not burn unless it is dry or unless it is hollow. But surely the badass is the small animals which can only jump and can't run. They get devastated, they die. And floods, as far they are equally devastated. In floods, nothing is left. In fire, at least big trees are left. In India, we don't have, we have ground fire. A majority of fires are ground fires and not crown fire. Crown fire raised to the top, to the crown level, and the whole ecosystem, the whole forest is devastated. This normally happens only in the trees which have got raisins, coniferous forest, higher in Himalayas, for example. Otherwise, India is not known for crown fires, but ground fires. And let me also tell you, majority of the fires in India, more than 90% of forest fires are human-generated because of either, you know, for well-defined reasons, like, you know, like making way through forest, or for collecting, for example, antelope horns, or for regeneration of the grass for grazing cattle, or for anything else. And floods, of course, we don't initiate, but humans are certainly helpful in, I mean, otherwise helpful to in floods. In Kedarnath, you know, tragedy, although humans were not directly related, but then the flood, you know, ravished thousands of people, and the chunks of also, you know, got washed off, so also the human settlements along the river. So natural calamities are devastating, massive impact, and lives of all kind, both plants and animals, they are lost. Habitat encroachment, I said earlier, as humans have swelled over time, they also encroached some of the protected areas. Like in Mumbai, if you know the Sanjay Gandhi National Park, earlier called as Borivali National Park, a lot of its area, about 10 to 12% is encroached. Sometimes back, maybe, I think about 10 years back, 8 years back, High Court of Mumbai, I mean High Court of Maharashtra in Mumbai said that all people should be evicted. This work has been going on. I think 70-80% people have been evicted and 20% or 30% yet to go. It will be good in favor of wildlife if all people, we have enough land to populate or to settle down while in the protected area. And we put wildlife has got as much right over land and forest as humans have. So my wish list is that we should leave some areas as sanctum sanctorum for the biodiversity and wildlife. And in other areas which are not agricultural productive lands, we normally use for food production, they should be the areas which can be, should be developed normally for the human settlements. Although this this idea would not be, I mean, subscribed by many, but then these are the ways by through which we can live a little more sustainably and make a wise use of land, rather than, you know, settling anywhere I wish or settling anywhere I find comfortable or something like that. In fact, we haven't learned, and we have no plan to develop sustainably, whether it be agriculture, ourselves, develop forest, or develop wildlife, or conserve wildlife. They're all questions which are interrelated. Then the last point, poaching and hunting, they simply go on night and day. So therefore, some foresters have to be awake even during night, because poachers don't have any timings to get into forest and hunt whatever they can. This has been going, this almost same story in all states across India. And earlier hunting was a legalized thing in the olden times, I mean 50-60 years back, but now it is banned. Hunting is allowed only in exceptional cases, when an animal becomes manager or an animal becomes a net nuisance to agriculture, which is even more importance than the animal. And of course, poaching is for a variety of, you know, selling parts of the body of the wild animals to foreign, you know, buyers. And you must be knowing the hunting and poaching of rhinos and leopards and tigers. And every now and then, if you read newspaper, you will get some state champion and this and that. But two states have emerged as tiger protecting states. One is Karnataka and second is Uttarakhand. So all hats off to these two states. They are doing wonder job. I hope they will better and come to a state when no there are no leopards hunted for any reason for that matter. Wildlife management does, needs factual information, spatial data. I hope you know what is spatial data. It needs information on wild animals, their number, their density and variety, because they make for wild animal census of all kinds, both herbivores and carnivores needs to be done. Carnivores depend on herbivores. Herbivores depend on the green biomass as a browse biomass which, as fodder. Then you need information on physical parameters of the habitat, that is food fodder or prey and fodder. Shelter includes terrain, terrain includes, slope, aspect, elevation, land use, land cover, of course, and water. These are the information types which are also needed. Then third one, information on basic biotic, biotic interference is needed, because if you know this, then perhaps you can plan better. You can also find out areas which activities are more, and you can pay special attention to these areas, because otherwise they will be lost totally to the even biotic disturbance, and even forest area could be wiped off over long periods of time. So first one is to check these activities and to see that you have factual information, because this information can be useful in wildlife habitat evaluation to a large extent. Now, information that remote sensing can provide is like this. Information on land cover, land use, very good. These days, high resolution data can tell you the factual land use, land cover through interpretation. Information on prey and fodder, of course, are food and fodder, you can call partially, because part of it comes from field by way of sampling the browse biomass. Not all species of plants which are in forest are eaten, are browsed by herbivores, because they are not all are not palatable. In one study which we did in Raja National Park in Uttarakhand, Shivaliks, we found that nearly 50% of species only are palatable to the elephant and other herbivores. Then we need information on water and drainage, because water will act as water holes for wildlife, and of course drainage pattern too makes an area, drainage pattern, it could be of advantage if it has got water around the year. Drainage pattern, deep ravines, for example, could be a problem for wildlife and even for the plants. Information on terrain, you need slope, aspect, elevation, because these sometimes work as a deterrent, sometimes they promote wildlife and so on and so forth. So you got to have this information, and these days all that always comes from the remote sensing. Earlier we used to take contours from Survey of India topo maps and digitize contours and create digital elevation model and also create slope aspect elevation maps from that. So many of point number four and point number three earlier used to come from Survey of India topo sheet, but now you can directly extract from the satellite imagery, especially high resolution one. STSL information comes from Survey of India topo map and forest department records, like information on settlements, the roads and boundaries. Settlements is the one which never comes from remote sensing. Only settlements could be, sprawl could be mapped, how, what way or in which direction urban settlement or village settlements, village settlements is increasing or spread or sprawl. Most sometime from satellite imagery, yes, and most of the time from Survey of India, but Survey of India maps available to the public, they don't have latest road. They are also using satellite imagery for updating their roads. Boundaries are something which you have to depend on either Survey of India or from the forest department records. Survey of India takes forest boundaries from forest departments, and sometimes they sew it on topo sheets. And so you do need information, whether it comes from remote sensing or some other source, to be able to scientifically evaluate for X or Y species of animal the habitat suitability. And you will see one example as to how I have done and how you can do. Now, this is the simplest schematic view of wildlife habitat evaluation methodology. You see, there are three boxes. They are simply sources, satellite image, Survey of India topo map, and field survey. Field survey gives a lot of idea about fodder, prey, their density, abundance, their location, and also their habitat preference. If you see a particular animal, let's say, in a particular area repeatedly, or a group of animals in particular, that shows that this area is perhaps, you know, preferred by this category of animals. And you generally, from the field survey, you give similar areas a high rating, which means they are suitable, because if they are herbivores, then grass should be enough, or leaves falling from the tree should be enough in that area. And you can run several statistical, analysis procedures which can remove the redundancy in field observations, and which helps ultimately in deciding the criteria or rules for modeling, and then the products which come from Survey of India used to come, but also now open source DTMs of Aster and SRTM, and also Cartodem are available, and one can use, because slope, aspect, and elevation do influence the existence, survival, and perpetuation of wildlife. Satellite imagery, as I said, gives good spatial data on land use, land cover, water bodies, and so on. But the most difficult is normally to decide rules. But everybody is not an animal expert, or more so the species habitat expert, I would say. And those who are, they can help a lot in framing the rules and criteria. You can write a software, you can use a program, or you can simply regress this with all this and find out your own coefficient through multiple logistic regression, and then use this spatial data in GIS for the modeling. Finally, some 8 to 10 layers will end up in one single map called as wildlife habitat suitability, or you can call it, let's say, barking deer habitat suitability or elephant habitat suitability. And one problem is that when you are looking for carnivorous animal, you have to first work out the habitat suitability for herbivores. And then, of course, once you have done it, you can use this information, spatial information, for the carnivorous animal habitat suitability analysis. Now I go on to the case study which I did long back in Uttarakhand. There is a place called Rani Khet, and this is the forest area where I operated. It's about 10 by 10 kilometer. It is used by army but managed by forest department. Since it is used by army, not many people venture into this, although on periphery it is still disturbed. And it has got perennial water sources like these blue lines, and the contour density is very high. The source that this area is mountainous. Mountainous areas pose challenges not only to humans but also for wildlife. We studied two animals' habitat suitability. One is barking deer. I hope you can identify. This one is barking deer and this one is sambar. And these two animals were habitat and relationship was studied first in field for 2 months continuously, then another 4 months habitat evaluation through modeling. In this case, since it was a very prelim kind of study, we used a simple linear additive models. And we use empirical weights based on our fieldwork, and this is a basic principle, in fact, which all wildlife habitat evaluation models also. If an animal is repeatedly seen at one place, or often seen at one place, that place is considered suitable. And in any regression, you know, logistic regression, such areas will be rated very high, because if large number of animals use that area, then surely that area is very, yes, is highly suitable. So all models conclude or deduce this kind of conclusions, and then try to model the rest of the habitat. We used a simple approach because it was a work which we wanted to demonstrate to our students so they can take up more complex problems in future. Now this is the list 3 false color composite of this forest area. The bright color is oak, not so bright over here the oak and pine, and here both somewhere, like for example here oak is more and for example here pine is more, and this hue or tone or color is poor pine stands, and see the density of pine for example over here is much more. This and this is pine and this is mixed pine. Pine is there but proportion is different, and sometimes you know slope and the hill shadow gives you a darker tone, although they need not to be necessarily different, so this is confusing. This is the fruit research station of earlier Uttar Pradesh, now Uttarakhand, and this is the road which goes to Nainital, and this is the road which goes to Almora, and here is the town of Nainital. For you, what is important, which inputs comes from where, how data is integrated through a model, whatsoever simple or complex it is, and what are the benefit that you get in terms of you know habitat management from these outputs. Now digital terrain model as this slide shows is helpful because it gives you the 3D view of the terrain, and like suppose if there is a fire in my protected area, I should know which is the shortest route to reach or approach or access so that this fire could be put off. Or for any other, you know, forest emergency operations, foresters would be interested to have a 3D model which you can actually rotate and see the pathway or the passes through it one can pass and reach to the site which is affected or which is under question and could be managed either in terms of fire, poaching or anything else. So you will see several 3D models over here. This is the view from south, digital terrain model, three-dimensional earth surface. And this is a false color composite draped over digital terrain model. And you can see this is south, and so opposite to south is north, and this is east, and this is west. So it is helpful. For example, if your office is located here, it comes to me that you can see your area either going along the ridge or you can go along the valley, and if it is incident is here, then perhaps valley is better than going through ridge, and etc. etc. You see, there is a road going on the top of the ridge which goes to Nainital, you know, like this somewhere. Okay, so 3D views are important because they are important from the access point of view, management point of view. There is a view from south, and you can see the area which is brighter red is our study area, and we took 10 by 10 kilometer, 100 square kilometer total area. There are all views which we could compile, and south view and of course the west view and the north view and so on. See, these views can be created in Adas Imagine, and you can rotate and then you can have a fly through you as if you are flying over the protected area. All that facility today exists in digital image processing arena. Then of course from field we derive a lot of important conclusions. For example, which habitat, like here is the aspect classes. Which aspect class is used by these two animals, and these two colors are for these two animals, you know. Barking deer is a small animal, it remains in valley bottom and never beyond mid slopes. While sambar tours the almost entire area or its territory, because and it goes, even it comes to the road where vehicles are plying, goes across in agricultural fields, pine forest and so on. And so it is likely that no larger area could be suitable for this animal for survival. Compared to this, whose mobility is limited, you will see the impact of this animal habit over the model products, which is very obvious. And you see here, for example, this aspect, I mean south aspect, because this area is very cool in winter, south aspect is preferred. Southwest aspect is preferred, and to certain degree an eastern aspect is preferred. So, and I mean the two animals, one is large, so its preference also proportionately large. But at some places, for example here, I can't read it from which aspect it is, but barking deer has got an edge over the sambar. But that is only an exception. Most of the time, I mean, it is other way around. Now, sambar and barking deer pellet counts, pellet groups count in different habitats. You see oak, rather deodar forest in this case was most preferred by the two animals. Although for walking deer, this was not different from oak, but for surely for sambar it was different. And this all comes, this all comes from field, and we have to do a lot of, visits to the field, sometimes stay overnight over them is, and be where they graze, what they browse, where they live, etc., etc. That gives you a whole lot of insight about species habitat relationship, which actually goes an input to the model. Then we need to create layers for the permanent drainage where animals can have water around the year, and normally for this purpose we take only permanent drainage system, not the temporary ones. And here in the study area there was a single lever, but then you can see these heads, and we created buffer. Buffer creating is for taking into account the animal's presence from the permanent water source. If animal concept is like this: if animal is away from the water source, it is a distress than an animal which is close to the water source. So we create buffer. These days people don't use buffer, they use Euclidean distance, which is progressive, and that is better, because you see all this area which is white in color will be assumed as beyond, let's say 1,000 meters, and this area is also beyond, this area is also beyond, this is also beyond for this, and for this also this is beyond. So the entire category gets into one category, right from this blue to that blue, which is not very good sign. Euclidean distance is far better, and people have already gone for that. Then we created settlement buffer. These buffer width zones can be set by individual workers, depend on the animals. For example, for an elephant or a large animal like tiger or leopard, these buffers are meaningless, because in daily course of wandering or daily course of life, they only have a territory, and this territory is large enough. So if you create only 250 buffer or 500, it is perhaps meaningless for elephants. Although for leopards it could be perhaps, although not necessarily. So you have to look at animals, how much, and its ranging habit, how much in daily course of life it travels, and buffers are set accordingly. Or if you're using Euclidean distance, then all this doesn't matter, and you can use that. So ranging habits, the size of animal is related to ranging habits, and so on and so forth. So also we create a smaller buffers over here, distance from the settlements. While the animals are really scared of human settlements, they only visit human settlements when they are sick, when they are old, when they are incapable of hunting. Humans, of course, they intrude their habitats, and whatever they see that they want to accept, that is another problem. But then wild animals, unless disturbed, they don't attack. Even any animal, for example, it is known inherently they are not man-eaters. They don't bother unless you get too close to them, or you try to disturb them, then of course surely they attack. So in a forest you are safe unless you get into too much proximity of a wild, ferocious man-eater, Carnivorous is not man-eater, animal, but surely it will attack. It may not eat you, but surely it will attack in self-defense. And it is said in Indian laws for humans, if you kill somebody in self-defense, it is not a crime. So if wild animal kills you, it's not a crime. And if you apply same law to wild animals, of course. Then roads provide access to the wild reserves. We created some buffer of 25, 50, 75, 100 meters. And we tried to separate, metal road from unmetal one. But then in later course of analysis, we find both the roads do the same job, because these days people have powerful vehicles. They can go anywhere, provided roads are even leveled. And so we thought we'll give a different weight to the metal road and not so good weight to the unmetal road. But this after field work, we abandoned and we gave same weightage. Weightage is a process in giving weightage to a particular parameters in model is a regular kind of activity, and you will see the impact of this. In the aspect of classes, we created 8 aspects, and when there are too many database layers, special database layers, and in each layer there are too many classes, like you see here, 8 classes, then it becomes a problem for any modeler. At the end, when you get one single layer and all these input layers are bound to that, it's sometimes difficult to provide thresholds to recategorize the gray values or gray value map into 4 classes: highly suitable, suitable, moderately suitable, or just unsuitable. So what everybody does, they pre-rate before this input is provided to model into just 4 class. And they try to make out which among this is highly suitable, say aspect, which is moderately suitable by field knowledge or by book knowledge or by practical experience. And then they will reduce the dimensionality from 8 classes to 4 classes, and these 4 classes will be directly translatable into highly suitable to unsuitable. This everybody does to reduce the dimensionality of the end product and have control over what you really want to get. Similarly, here I have already generated from DTM the slope map. This slope map has got only 4 categories. Higher the category, less is the suitability. That is the concept. So the bottom one, more than 60 degree slope, is really not suitable. While 30-60 moderately suitable, 18-20 suitable, and 0-15 highly suitable, which would be in this area of valley bottoms. Now we turn to elevation classes, and they vary from about little less than 1,650 meters, which is quite high, very cool place. And the top of the peak in the study area was about 2,100 meters, about 6,000 plus feet. And area is year-round, like a hill station, and most of it, green one is pine, you see. There is the highest point, and then the next, so on. This is a product from SRTM, but in our case, those days there was no SRTM. So we had to digitize and spend a month in digitizing contours, because they were too close by. We could get a product which otherwise was not available in free domain for use by scientists or for anybody for that matter. These are the forest types and use land cover classes. You can see even military playgrounds over here, the pine. These are the fallow land, most of it yellow. The mixed vegetation, which is orange, oak, parrot green, and so on. Here again, we have many classes, so you will see the some maps wherein I have reclassified or weighted them into just 4 categories. This is land use land cover map, or forest type map, you can call it, if you don't want to talk about others. In draped over the 3-dimensional perspective of the terrain, this is just to give an idea of which forest exists on which terrain, basically. And you see, 3 classes. Density is also important from wild animal point of view. And while interpreting we start to it that we make only four classes, not many classes, because listening data can give only these four. And you see the maximum is the one which is 1 to 2%. Then the next category is red, next one is blue, and then the least one is this one. So that means majority of forest is of medium density. In a study area, in particularly this area, it was medium to high density. This is canopy density obtained from satellite imagery. The habitat type rating is, I have rated with settlements, fallow land, least suitable, oak, pine, and mixed, highly suitable. So from 8, 9 classes, I have zeroed down to, I have reclassified or rated them into just 4, because finally the end classes which I want to make will be just highly suitable, suitable, moderately suitable, and unsuitable. Many of you might be knowing about multi-criteria analysis and AHP. If you know that, then you can also create a wildlife habitat, you know, model with the, and you can have the coefficient which are derived by pairwise, you know, analysis or comparison, and generate your own, you know, coefficients or eigenvalues which are used in the model. Then you don't have to empirically decide whether I have to assign 0.9 or 0.8 or 0.3 to finally to the model. Here again, aspect rated, you know, into 4 classes. Then this is the complete picture of this wildlife habitat evaluation. You see the same, you cite but not in so detail are there. Survey of India topo sheet, or you can see even some of it from satellite imagery or SRTM. Then satellite imagery helps majorly in forest type, land use land cover map, and forest density, forest canopy density map. Field survey is a multi-dimensional activity. You have to be in field, watch animals, pictures, see what they eat, and see where they, pass night, where they spend most of their time, and what do they browse, and etc. It's a whole lot of activities, not just coming like to going like tourists and seeing them coming back. Then you sit on field data analysis. You can use SPSS, many of the softwares are there, statistical. You can do a principal component analysis to weed out redundancy, cluster analysis, correlation analysis, analysis of variance. And then finally you have points, and these points get into this model. These also make a spatial data layer. These days you can use GPS for location of animals, and if you are a botanist, all the better to know what they eat, and if you are a geologist, at least you will have a lot of idea about animals. So anybody fits into this kitty. I have in my lab computer engineers who are working on habitat models, 8 models at a time, then running an ensemble model to find out which model fits best in the kitty or works better than the other one, and which one is perhaps the best kind of situation. So background is no problem. You should have interest. You should know how to process data. You should know how to write codes, because to do this, you need to sometimes write code, or how to run a logistic regression, you know, program, etc., etc. And then you sit with all these cleaned database layers, each one with 4 categories, and this as well, and pass through the model and get a habitat suitability map. So a lot of activity, whole lot of responsibility to generate quality data with more than 90%, you know, accuracy, static accuracy, and so also the positional accuracy. And all those skills are used till you reach to a clean number of files, and also clear information from field and integrate into one, and you will see how. Now look at this flower type of diagram. These were my input for the this barking deer and sambar habitat evaluation. I did for 2 because my student, she was interested. I said, go ahead. Those days we did not use any, as I said earlier, any logistic regression. Rather, habitat suitability index we generated. This index was equal to 0.8. Forest type. 0.8 is the weight given to the forest type, those 4 categories. 0.72 for residency, 0.7 to what body or what holes, 0.6 to aspect, 0.5 to slope, 0.4 to elevation, 0.2 to settlements, and 0.1 each into metal layer, unmetal coat, and finally got one single layer, about 14 gray values, which we again thresholded are grouped into 4, because finally I want only 4 categories in a habitat suitability map. Now you look at this habitat suitability analysis for summer, and this is the product, and this product shows which area is highly suitable, yellow, suitable red, most, and moderately suitable, of course, blue, and unsuitable, lot of area was unsuitable. This is for summer. Summer is still a large animal, so its habitat suitability will be widely located, or you can say larger areas, or many areas, in other words, can be suitable, because animal, because it walks across the terrain, many habitats which otherwise are inaccessible and therefore unsuitable for barking deer naturally become suitable for the summer. So if you see the next one, please remember this, lot of red here, and also lot of for the time being I'll take only these two classes, and also blue. Let's see, quite a lot of area are, let us say, from most suitable, highly suitable to moderately suitable, all right? And you will see the next for the barking deer. You see here, lot of area have gone green here, that means unsuitable. Yellow spread has reduced, so also the spread of red. Why? Because this animal is small, doesn't move much, and therefore its choice for habitat suitability, or access to the habitat surrounding is limited, and therefore within the limited available habitat, this much area is suitable for the barking deer. Now here is another study. I have only half a dozen slides left. Now the another study which we did for mountain goat is called Goral. Goral is the mother of all goats in India, except the ones in Assam and also Jammu and Kashmir. Most of the goats from central Indian Himalayan region, domestic goats, they come, they are the, you know, offsprings or the generations domesticated from the wild mountain goat. And these goats are famous because they live in the cliffs. They are only on the top of the gorges in the hilly and mountainous areas, and their only defense is either to fight through horns or to stay in places like cliffs and run back to these cliffs when a tiger or a leopard attacks them. For some period of time, they can run faster than these two animals to climb the cliffs. Tigers and the panthers cannot do it so fast, and that is their defense. So the lesson for modelers or evaluators of habitat is that give high weightage to the cliffs or to the hill slopes which are steep, because if animal is not there, if animal cannot protect, it will also not survive. Very difficult to assume that goats can survive amidst tiger and leopards, but it does, mountain goat does, by making cliffs and the peaks and the ridges and the tops of the hills and mountains as their habitat, because that is the only way they can save themselves and survive. So when you model, you create an elevation or slope map, you should take special weightage to the mountainous or cliff areas. And GIS is a beautiful tool. It also gives you, for example, here if you see how much area is suitable, you find much of the area is only moderately suitable. Only some spots are suitable, and there is no area whatsoever which is highly suitable. All right, and this is Gujar, and I created a buffer of 3 kilometers along Gujar Deeras in Chilla Sanctuary. And because water bodies and settlements, everything was part of input. And you see this hole, because there happens to be a Gujar Deera, and it is relatively in not so hilly area, and GIS allows you to create scenario. What if, let us say, what if all Gujars are out tomorrow morning from the sanctuary? What happens? What does my model say? And you see here, there's no whole animal. Overall suitability of the habitat for Gurana has increased. You see more red patches, you see, but still there is no patch which is highly or more suitable. I was still surprised because while working with this animal, I found that increase from Gujars to no Gujars or minus Gujars is just 6.77%. I was hoping that more than 10 or 15% increase in the habitat suitability for Gora. So we were a little, you know, surprised or rather baffled what could be the reason. So we got into backward, you know, analysis and found that most of the Gujar families, they are not on cliffs. They are also not on very slopy mountain or hill regions. And therefore, there is hardly any habitat overlap between Gujars and mountain goat. Only this Gujar and likes over there. They were in conflict zones. They almost used the same bracket of the hill slope which was suitable also for the mountain goat. But overall, you see the base color, yellow color has increased. Red patches have increased to 5, 6, and still there is no highly suitable land. So parameters, habitat parameter which you use for modeling, one should be really aware of the habitat use or preference of the animal for habitat. Then you are better evaluated rather than just starting from scratch, not doing anything. You will anyway end up doing some modeling, but it won't be the it won't be impressive or it won't be realistic. Cost of this study in 2000 was about 1 lakh rupees, and it works out to be 400 rupees per square kilometer. Even if this 400 over time up to 2015 has become 5 times, let's say 2000 rupees, it is still worth, because in 2000 rupees, if you can make a habitat suitability model for X or Y animal in a kilometer square, it is still worth it. It is not a big amount of money. We spend a big amount for some other worthless activities. So this should be welcome. I also proposed, it is already in the state wherein it might be accepted by the by the Ministry of Environment and Forest, but I do not know as of now. I propose this model which talks in principle, theoretically, about all inputs that goes to the system, also which creates data and information, needs a lot of pre-processing, interoperability, field and remote sensing based data, and also data from wildlife conservation biology. Then you come to the next stage, which is all the part of Willis. They say the database is there, GIS is there, now you run models and do some analysis like metadata. And with that you can actually create a query shell, and this query shell can use all database metadata and create what are the areas above 1000 meter in Himalayas where Gural can be found. What are the areas of 1000 meters where we can have chance to see the let us say Kasturi buck or any other, so antelope or nilgai or anything else, and you can click on hypertext mode and you can get information about your district, about your protected area, about your state or whatsoever, and you can surely visualize many of the things. But database is there. So it needs, it takes time to create good database, clean built, and the inputs can come from anywhere. You can use even external models and expertise experts, and then these are the benefits, and you will have all information about wildlife under in one server or one system under one roof, and this is more important to preserve our information about wildlife at one place rather than have distributed information for particular area, go to ministry, for other thing, go to wildlife board, and for something else, you go to the Wildlife Institute of India, and for remote sensing in GIS, you go to Indian Institute of Remote Sensing. So information systems actually overcome all those problems, and maybe one day it will be accepted and it will be operational. Our forest information system is already accepted, and a protocol or work is already on Forest Survey of India, and similar to wildlife, you want to put all forestry related information in one server. It could be a distributed server and people share their server areas where information lies, and people are having access to that. Then of course the thrust area, this is for institutes like Wildlife Institute of India, IRS, because we do some kind of research. We are yet to work very seriously on biotic interference, man-animal conflict, because this is of grave concern of late. As humans are intruding into forests, encroaching forests, then there are bound to be more and more man and animal conflicts. It's not animal which actually come to humans, it is humans which go to animal, and therefore fault lies with the humans, not with the animal. If you shrink their habitat, they have their own corridors, they have the areas or gullies and corridors of movement, they keep coming to the village areas, because it is as to wild their corridor. Elephants do it very regularly, so also the rhino and many others. So humans are culprit, and serious thought needs to be given to analyze this man and animal conflict. Then the corridors corrective encroachment and increases carrying capacity, and all the most difficult is fourth one. But somebody has to do and make a beginning, and then time will come when perhaps we'll understand better than what we have today. Thank you very much.